I'd like to call this Bristol Borough Council work session to order. We have several people here this evening for different things, so I'm going to start with the redevelopment authority first. Mr. Bob White is here to speak on behalf, I guess, of Mill Run, correct?
Yeah, the Mill Run property. Also, I believe Jim wanted me to speak a little bit on the, we own five properties up on Mill Street that we would like to transfer back to the borough, because that happened about 15 years ago. We took out five stores that were falling down, and we were going to develop that, never happened. And now it's being used for a park, so we're going to transfer that back. I sent the information to Jim. On Mill Run, you know, you always look at a property and you think, when they get started, it's just going to go like gangbusters, but there's always hiccups. In that particular building, they're in doing the tear out, and of course, there was some asbestos in the basement, some asbestos probably in the mastic that holds down the tiles. And unfortunately, somebody anonymously sent notice to OSHA that it was there, and they came out and, of course, put the job on hold until we determine exactly what's there and how it's got to be handled. So from there, we had to go through and figure out how to get funding through the state to help clean it up. And we can only do that on industrial properties. So there I got a hospital. Most of you know it's been a hospital for a long time. But I took the time to pay a company to search the title. We found out it was actually owned by the shipbuilders, made it industrial. So then we had to go through the process of doing a write-up and application. In the meantime, the guy that has to make the decision got in a bad accident on Northeast Extension. So he was out for several months. But now, today, we just got the letter from the DEP that they okayed us to clean that property up. So I'm real happy about that. The next step, of course, is to send the grant application in. That'll be approved because the DEP actually puts the money in that. We couldn't put it in before we get the bids in, which will be in tomorrow by noon. We have 23 people pick the bids up. So we'll either have a long time trying to go through all of them and decipher who's the best one to do the project. Hopefully it'll be somebody local. We're always looking to keep the local people involved if we can. We do have a couple bids here from Bristol. So we'll open them tomorrow. We'll get to working on them. I keep all during the year, since we've sold the property to this group, I'm always by there looking at it. We keep an eye on it. The borough keeps an eye on it. And obviously the people that live around it keep an eye on it, because I get calls pretty often for things like that. I want to really rest everybody in this community. There's no asbestos in that building that's going to come out and attack anybody. It's in basically in the basement and in mastic, which has to be taken out. And it will be done in accordance with all the regulations and laws and, you know, that go with the DEP, this community, federal government, the Commonwealth. Goes through that, a report will be made. It'll be cleaned up. The DEP will give us a letter that it is cleaned up and there's no further action. At that time, hopefully these guys will be, before that, they'll be able to get back and finish doing their demo and start doing some of their, actually installing. They're going to do some construction. They got to come with some plans. They're working on that. I don't know if you want to.
Sure, happy
to. You could get up and speak to that.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mike Hollister. I saw you probably about 10 months ago, I believe, at this point, maybe a little longer, the attorney for the project. And where we are presently is while we've been stayed by OSHA and the DEP to deal with this asbestos issue, on the other hand, what we've done is we've been out in Harrisburg getting our licensing, starting our licensing process for the assisted living facility, for the scared kill facility, for hospice, and for home care. So we're trying to align our two paths so that when we are ready to open, we have all of our licensing completed, and once a certificate of occupancy is issued, we're able to go ahead and begin admitting patients. where we stand with the, we were in the process of finalizing the design plans for an additional two floors on top of the new addition to the building, the two-story structure. And I know we'll be presenting those to this body, I would like to think within the next, 45 days. That's my understanding on it. What else can I tell you at this point? As we get closer to opening, we're going to have an advisory board, and the advisory board will have professionals on it from the community, and then also we would like someone from either this body or an appointee to help administer it, because it is going to be a community-based facility, and we want to be a good neighbor. And I think really at this point, that's pretty much all I can add.
Does anybody have any questions for Mike? Tony?
The only question I have, how long do you foresee it taking to get the necessary licensing?
Well, that depends. So for the assisted living, which is the first part of the project that we're going to open, that is going to be a relatively routine process. That should take from start to finish, and finish it all ties into the certificate of occupancy is really sort of the timeline that the state uses in issuing these licenses. That could be a six-month process. So I don't want anyone to be under the misconception that it's 6 months from today.
Right, 6 months from when it ties up with the building.
Right, exactly. The skilled care, which is, you know, popularly known as nursing home license, that process is going to take longer. And I'm not being purposely cagey. I haven't received a timeline from the state. Because initially when we looked into this process, the state was, everyone that I was speaking with, the experts in this area, were saying, listen, the state is issuing a moratorium on new nursing home beds because there's a move away from nursing home facilities and people keeping people in their homes for as long as they can. But when we explained to them what our goal is with this facility and how it's going to be literally a transitional facility where you can come into the assisted living facility and then, you know, progress towards the skilled care facility, that got a lot of people interested. But I have yet to actually get a definitive timeline. So again, it will be tied to the opening of the building. And as I get more details, I can come back and update you.
Okay, thanks.
Just a request, and I firmly believe in our conversations that I've become very confident in what you guys are doing. And I think it was just a misunderstanding, kind of everyone's grass sneaks up on them, I think, at this time of year particularly. I just would like us, just for the sake of the people that are living there, I know that when this project is over, they're going to see the value in what is going on. But in the meantime, if we can just really stay on top of the care of the Just the manicuring,
absolutely,
really, of the outside.
Absolutely.
That would be,
we'll be a good neighbor.
Much,
yes,
appreciated. Mm-hmm. Which you guys have been, but I understand you went through some things, but that's really all that I wanted to say. So I appreciate it.
Can I ask, with the assisted living, how many beds do you anticipate are going to be in that building or that part of the building?
The assisted living, I think at this point we are dedicating 60,000 square feet to it. 48,000 square feet. So let me get back to you on the number of beds. I actually, as I stand here right now, I don't know. I
believe it would be 120 beds.
120 beds?
Okay. Remember. So that's for that part, and then you're going to have the skilled care is going to be separate from the assistant.
Correct. And I know we're looking to apply for a license for 100 skilled care beds.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Everybody's okay with everything?
Oh, I'm sorry. There's one last thing I just wanted. I apologize. It just hit me. I saw Mr. White and it hit me. I do know that people that are really paying close attention were surprised to see when the bids went out for the cleanup that it was in the name of the Redevelopment Authority as opposed to the owners, the purchasers of the property. And I think Mr. White made it clear that that is a safeguard for us in the event, and like I said, we've all got a great relationship now and we're not feeling that way, but in the event that something were to go awry, that the Redevelopment Authority has the right to say, we're going to make sure this project gets done the right way. So it's still that the redevelopment authority has a lot of authority over what is being put out.
Oh, yeah. No, absolutely.
Yes. I just want to make sure people understood that because it was in the paper, and I know a few people were like, wait a minute, confused as to whose project this is. So.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right, guys. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us, man.
It's always a pleasure. We get into council. I don't want to hold this other group up. I know, Dr. Rattini, you're here to speak on behalf of, my mind just drew a blank, Elkhorn. So, on behalf of.
Sort of a little different than CERN
about Elkhorn.
I have papers. I don't know if I can. What I have is, I'm coming tonight to ask members of council to consider passing a resolution that would.
They're not going to hear you unless you're at home, unless you're speaking with that mic. You can walk around with it if you want, Doc.
Okay. I'll just hand these papers. I just wanted to know if council would consider passing a resolution that they could take to Falls Township to let them know where we stand as far as the building of the hazardous waste plant, processing plant in Falls Township. And I have some, I was given a document that was a resolution, but it was a 5-page resolution, which is what the same resolution, I believe, Upper Makefield passed. But I didn't feel comfortable giving you a resolution that I had not vetted and fact-checked myself. So the resolution I'm giving you is a much shorter one. It's concise, but I think that it'll still serve its purpose to show that this is not something that we need or want in our area. So what I have is I have a copy of the proposed resolution. I'm sure you'll want your solicitor to look at it or whatever, but this is some copies of that. I don't know where it is.
You could pass them out.
Okay. Can I just give you those to pass this way? I have a copy of my presentation. I don't know if you need that, but I'll give you that copy. Yeah. And this is just a copy of what Philadelphia water commissioners have said about this project and how they are definitely opposed to it also. So, and that's really an eye-opener. So what I wanted to say is it seems like I only ever come here to talk about hazardous waste, sorry. But the Elkhorn's proposed hazardous waste treatment plant is located within a half mile of the tributaries that feed into the Delaware River up in Falls Township, and it's within a mile of the river. I've looked at the floodplain maps, and there was some question as to whether or not some of the spur lines were located in the 500-year floodplain, and they actually were. And then Elkhorn rescinded and said, well, we won't put anything there. But, I just so that you know, it is in the wetlands. Elkhorn has also vehemently denied that their plant is an incinerator, and they've chosen to use the term thermal oxidation. But the EPA actually states that thermal oxidation plant is indeed an incinerator. So besides worrying about the health of our water system and our water supply, you really have to worry about the air. Now, granted, we don't, with the winds prevailing, we don't usually get winds from that area, but they do flow across the river. They flow onto our neighbors in New Jersey and up county. What they are proposed to do with this thermal oxidation plant is to bring in liquid hazardous waste, and by method of this process of thermal oxidation, they're going to be left with some solid matter that they will then have to take to a hazardous waste dump. So besides having trucks come in full of hazardous waste that is not from our area, they will also be taking out hazardous waste. Elkhorn has run afoul of Israel's Environmental Protection Ministry for a hazardous waste plant that it has in their country. They found that the waste products that they were producing contained a much higher level of dangerous hazardous pollutants that they said that they were going to, and they were being actually disposed of in an inappropriate manner into treatment pools in Galilee. So that's who we're dealing with here. Our town is one of the few municipalities in the surrounding area that has not formally voiced concern or opposition to the looming threat to our air quality, water supply, health, and property values. I think that because of this inertia, we may actually then bear the brunt of a lot of the negative impact that Elkhorn will have on our part of the county. Pressure from Marsville and Lower Makefield, Elkhorn stated that they will not allow trucks to take the route down Pennsylvania Avenue through Marsville. Bristol Township tried to get them to do the same thing with Route 13, and Elkhorn has not agreed to that demand. So likely this means that the trucks of hazardous waste will be coming down 13, or possibly even the center of our town, because you know the way to get to Falls Township is either one of those two routes from I-95, from the Turnpike. My concern, you know, as a physician, is that the major spill on Route 13 would effectively cut our town off from all emergency management resources and would severely limit our evacuation options. I'm sure Mr. Winslow would know much more about this than me, but it just seems to me that there's not a whole lot of ways out of our town between north and south if you cut off Route 13. So the towns that line the Delaware on the Jersey side have been very vocal in their opposition to Elkhorn. And that's Florence, Burlington, Bordentown. And besides Bristol Township, Marsville, Lower Makefield, and Lower Bucks County, and the Town Council of Upper Makefield have passed resolutions that said Upper Makefield's is actually a five-page extensive resolution outlining all the deleterious effects that Elkhorn Hazardous Waste Treatment Plant could have on our region. But perhaps the most damning, what I feel is the most damning of all opposition, is this extensive report by the Philadelphia Water Authority. And that I gave copies to so that you could read in its entirety. But if a spill were to occur at the proposed plant in Falls Township, the toxic material would take but a few days to end up in the drinking water supply for the 2.5 million people in Philadelphia and their surrounding area that rely on that water. They use this model called the Delaware Valley Early Warning System titled Spill Model. It would take, obviously, much less time for that to enter into our water intake and affect our water. The Philadelphia Water Authority, in their resolution, also pointed to the recent massive toxic spill in West Virginia's Elk River that was caused by a chemical storage facility leak as a possible scenario of what could happen in the Delaware if this plant were allowed to move forward. There's another tool. I mean, there's all kinds of health and economic assessment tools that you could, that if the water authorities in Bristol wanted to see and use, they're available to assess the risk of our own water supply. And if we are not going to go through with a resolution, I would highly recommend that they do this. I don't see any valid reason why we need to bring more high-risk toxic chemicals onto our roads through our densely populated areas to be processed in a plant in the aquifer of the Delaware River that we all rely on for our drinking and clean water needs. I think that any risk at all to the health and safety of our community is way too big of a risk. The fact that Elkhorn said that they will place alarms on the tanks in case of overfill and that they will train their employees and truck drivers how to handle toxic spills, I believe that just underscores the fact that this is a risky process. Lower Bucks has assumed too much of the burden of the waste from other states, and it's definitely time for us to step up and to protect the health and safety of our citizens from the hazards of this hazardous waste treatment plan. So, I mean, I'm not an authority on the process that Elkhorn is using. There's probably better people that could answer those questions, but I did read a lot about it, and I'm definitely more than extremely concerned that this is not what you want to have down the road.
Have you been attending the Falls Township meeting?
Yes, I have. I've attended most of them.
You think this is going to pass? I mean,
I think that I personally and
I know, I'm just like that,
Falls, I don't think Falls Township. Yeah, I think that Falls Township does not seem to have a problem with this, because they're pointing to the fact, well, you know, it's an industrial area, but that's not the point. The point is, you don't, just because you have an area that already has a lot of heavy industry does not mean that we need to import more and import more trash. I mean, Pennsylvania is the leader in importing waste. You know, and Bucks County is like kind of the nidus of that, and most of the waste does end up here. So I'm concerned health, I'm concerned about safety, but, I mean, you have to look at things like, you know, your property values. I mean, it's all, it all enters into the fact that this is just not something that you want to have here. Elkhorn, I mean, at the meetings that I've attended, they backpedal an awful lot. Like, they'll give some presentation, they don't really state a lot of facts, and when they do state facts, then they come to the next meeting and change those facts. So it's very hard to pin them down. I think that they're just trying to please everybody and kind of maybe make some of the opposition go away is the feeling that I get.
I just think as a borough, we need to take every precaution we can to keep our residents safe and to keep them. And we do have state highways. Bath, Otter, and Ratcliffe are state roads.
Right.
It's going to be pretty hard for us to stop these trucks from coming through town. We're on a state highway. I mean, I could be wrong, but I think with enforcement with police to make sure they're doing the speed limit and they're not overweight. And I think we'll do everything we can as a town and as a council within our legal rights to protect this. I don't see why the solicitor can't review an ordinance and we can't vote on an ordinance, whether it carries any merit or not. I don't know.
I don't know if it would either. But it's worth a shot.
And if I just might interject, I think Dr. Rattini's point, I'm sure you were saying the same thing, Ralph, is that while you might be right, you probably are right about what kind of official recourse we have, I think it's always good for people in our area to go on record about how we feel about these things. Because if you remember with the incinerator, one thing that I think really did resonate with a lot of people is it may be more anecdotal, and I think Dr. Rattini's talking about some hard, fast statistics, that it just feels like we're kind of surrounded on all sides by these massive industrial kind of, whether it be waste or incinerators or what Elkhorn's proposing. And it does feel disproportionate. It feels like not only Bucks County, but that lower Bucks County bears the brunt end of that. And, you know, I have my theories on why that is, but I think it's important that we go on record.
There's a lot of environmental justice issues. I mean, there's a lot of different reasons why this should not be allowed.
When do you think a decision would be voted on with Falls Township?
I think that they're going to have to wait until after. I could be wrong, and if I am, please stop me. But I think that they are probably going to wait and see what the EPA does in this phase two siting.
Within 30 days, 60 days?
I would say it's dragging on and on.
I think currently, Elkhorn has not submitted their next permit application.
Okay.
As soon as they apply, it's overdue. They said 2 months ago they were going to do it. They haven't done it yet, but they could do it at any day. DEP has 90 days in order to determine its completeness or not. Once that 90-day period is up, they make that declaration, and then there's a 10-month review process. DEP has 10 months to review the application, and in that time there will be public meetings, comment periods, and that sort of thing.
The reason I'm asking is because for us to pass an ordinance, we need to have the solicitor look at it, draft up the ordinance, whether it's word for word that Melinda typed up, and that resolution, and then we have to advertise it, and if we have to go that route,
not the resolution.
We could just get it passed.
Yeah,
you're okay.
Okay. Any questions? Thank you so much for letting me speak.
All right.
I really appreciate it.
Are we all okay? Is anybody else, or we're good with what Melinda said?
I would only add, my name is Fred Stein. I work with the Delaware Riverkeeper Network. In our office, we're a nonprofit environmental advocacy organization, but we rent a space on Canal Street at the in the Grundy. Yeah, right here, right there, seventh floor. I'm in the interior in a little cubicle, but that's beside the point. But anyway, as a renter and a business in the borough, we would really support and thank you for taking this stand, because it's a resolution, but it is an official statement, and that carries weight with DEP and with local legislators. They'll see what their constituent towns and mayors and council and all that are supporting, and it gives them cover, and they can stand up, and everybody will stand up and say no to Elkhorn, and that's our, as an organization, we put a lot of priority on where we're renting. We had an opportunity to rent, actually buy a parcel in Yardley, but it was in the 100-year floodplain, and we stepped back because we knew that would be, that's what we fight against most of the time, so we would support this because this makes our community where our employees come just that much safer.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Just real quick, where is all this hazardous material being disposed of now?
Well, that's a good question. It's not a great system now. From what we understand, there are there's deep well injection, you know, and it's in a variety of different locations. It might be Ohio. It might be Arkansas. I'm not really sure the specific areas. So what this is a step in the right direction technology-wise, but it's the wrong location. You don't, their phase one permit says they'll bring in as much as 210,000 tons of chemical hazardous waste every year. And so that's stuff that's already, we're already generating that out there, and it's being treated and done something with. But you don't bring it less than a half a mile to the drink of the drinking water for millions
of
people.
So basically you're saying this Elkhorn is actually an improved method of disposing this stuff. It's just they got to find the right location to process it.
You know, I don't know I know the thermal oxidation process that they're proposing is going to produce 25 tons of air emissions, toxic air emissions every year. So that may be a step in the right direction. I don't know. It doesn't sound like it. I don't want to just spin that kind of a fact, but pumping it in deep well injection is not a good thing either.
Right.
We have to find a responsible way to do it,
right.
But we have to find a good location to do it in.
Okay. Thank you.
And there's only a one facility like this in the world. Unproven in one sense, so do we want to be the guinea pig?
Not me.
No, not me.
Do you want me to read the resolution, or is it okay that I...
We all have it.
Okay.
All right. Thank
if
you
and when we adopt it, we would read it then.
Okay. Are we done with Paul? Anybody else in the public want to speak on anything? Go to the podium and state your name for the record.
My name is Jacqueline Marish, and I live at 205 Pond Street, right across the street, as most of you already know. On December 9th of last year, I filed a civilian police complaint report regarding the blatant mishandling by Bristol Police of the vandalization and subsequent theft of my vehicle from the Grundy parking lot on September 3rd. Upon filing, I was asked if I would allow the December holidays to pass before the review board would meet. I agreed to relinquish the 10-day required response time. On December 19th, I received a letter from a Mr. Santone, chair of the review board, that my complaint had been received and the process of convening the board would begin in January. On February 1st, I received a letter from him stating that the board had actually met on January 27th. By March 1st, I received a letter calling for my attendance at the board's meeting on March 9th. I was interviewed for an hour. I advised the board in my, as you can imagine, lengthy complaint, and also during the interview, of the seriousness, avoidableness, and expensiveness of this entire situation for me. On March 31st, I received a copy of the March 30th letter that the Borough Council got and the Review Board's rational, responsible recommendations. I want to go over just some of the letters. I know you all got copies of the letters. I just want to read some things for the record. The first complaint, it says, the first aspect of Ms. Marish's complaint deals with the fact that she was never notified of the break-in of her vehicle. And then it goes on, but I will go on. Witnesses should never be left with the responsibility to notify a victim. The board, the review board, finds this unacceptable. The board feels leaving the vehicle unsecured likely contributed to the accessibility for the theft after the break-in. In the police chief's response letter to the board, he states, once the responding officer has completed a theft from vehicle investigation, the vehicle would then be, and this is in bold print, released back to the owner. This never occurred, nor did the responding officer secure the vehicle. In a verbal communication concerning this item from the review board with the former police chief, he stated, there are no written procedures covering thefts from vehicles. The board, the review board, urges the mayor to work with the police department to establish working procedures to ensure all aspects of these investigations are met. If the responding officer is unable to notify the victim, the necessity of securing vehicles and/or having them removed to a secure location within the borough is paramount. If impoundment is required, no fee should be attached. Of course, I paid $460 to get my car back. Towing fees are given. The board also recommends the borough council make available a suitable location, such as the borough works area, for temporary storage not to exceed a certain number of days. Second complaint. Ms. Mary states she waited 25 days for the incident report covering the break-in to her vehicle. Again, the board finds this unacceptable. Board recommendation. The board recommends the mayor and the acting police chief to work together to make changes to the incident reporting system to improve the timeliness of the availability of these reports. Last complaint. Although not related to police work or police misconduct, Ms. Marish finds the amount of time required to see the mayor unacceptable. She feels it should not have taken the mayor 45 days to meet with her. The board agrees with Ms. Marish and feels she was not properly served in this instance. The board urges Borough Council to accept the recommendations mentioned above. A letter reflecting council's acceptance or rejection should be forwarded to the board within 30 days of the date of this March 30th letter. If accepted, council should submit the action items to the responsible parties with a deadline for their completion. The 30-day response time has obviously now been bypassed. I'm here to urge the Borough Council to accept the review board's recommendations and to notify the review board in writing so that a copy of that response can be sent to me, which Mr. Santone, chair of the review board, informed me I am entitled to receive. I have also just learned that there is a new police chief and that all of the information has been turned over to that person, and so I look forward to some sort of resolution.
I'm going to have, okay. Are you done?
I'm done.
Do you want to respond to her? I just want this solicitor to explain something.
I understand Mrs. Marish's frustration, but there's a procedure here under this ordinance, which, of course, keeps the preliminary investigation very confidential for obvious reasons. And you followed through and did your part, and I think the review board did its part. It did make a recommendation, which was submitted to the former chief and the mayor, and I guess with the transition and all, it was not addressed. I've resubmitted it to Chief Henry, and we're asking him to review it because there are recommendations for some procedures. Asked him to review it with the mayor and then make their recommendations to council, at which point council will make any decisions it has to make. It may not need to make any decisions if the chief and the mayor agree with the recommendations. They may just implement them. Because a lot of them have to do with reporting, lack of reporting procedures, or lack of compliance with reporting procedures. So we're going to ask I don't think it's appropriate to have this discussion on the floor at this point because we're still within that procedure. But I think Chief Henry, I sent it to you last week.
Yes, sir.
And I know you're busy with a lot of things.
Oh, but
I would ask you to maybe push that up on your pile a little bit.
Sure.
Discuss it with the mayor. It's not very complicated, and let's get a recommendation and let's move forward and give Mrs. Marish some satisfaction.
Thank you.
So we appreciate your continued patience.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Public participation? Public participation. Okay, Herbie, what do you have?
Just two things. Back in April 20th, we had a fire on Mill Street involving 233, 235, and 237, involving a barbecue grill on the roof of one of the buildings. And I'm still working with the insurance investigators, processing some of the information and helping them out to help determine a cause and the exact extent of the damages to the property there. The one place that's impacted is Cafe Bombay. So we're trying to speed that process up.
Please do. I love their food.
In working with the insurance companies. The second thing I have is that we finally exhausted our supply of 1,500 carbon monoxide alarms.
Oh, good.
We don't have any more, which is not good. It's good and it's not good. But we do have an active grant right now to try and obtain 600 additional carbon monoxide alarms. And the new ones, if we get the grant, will have 10-year batteries in them. So we won't have to worry about batteries with the smoke alarms or the carbon monoxide alarms. And last, we still have approximately 400 smoke alarms available. So we can still provide and install smoke alarms, but we do not have any more carbon monoxide alarms.
Any questions for a fire chief? Thank you. Chief.
Sure. We had a patrol meeting this following week. The entire department was together for over an hour and a half discussing goals and objectives, where they're at, where we would like to go, my expectations, and it went very well. I'm sure you've seen or heard some of the things we've already been moving on. You're seeing police officers in the schools, officers around the Memorial Day celebration, and we also have instituted some bike patrols, and we've also instituted some foot patrols, which we want to try to really push the envelope on that this year. Memorial Day was very busy for calls for service and also with proactivity, but overall it's been a good experience. I just want to encourage all the council members and the mayor, just as like I have all along this process, for the communication aspect of it. I have met with several of the council members, phone calls, emails, and the mayor back and forth. Please, if you have something, give us the opportunity to respond to it. And I think you'll find the response, you'll get a response one way or the other, and maybe it won't be as well as you would have liked it to be, but you will have a response. And we just appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you. Any questions for the chief?
No, I'd just like to make one comment to the people in the public. It just probably is in your best interest as well as the borough if you can call the non-emergency number when it's not an emergency, or call 911 when it is an emergency instead of trying to contact your council members, because it'll be something that's logged and more efficient for the police department. I know that's the way.
I appreciate you bringing that up, because we're going to push that envelope, and some of the people, it's not the way we're going to do business anymore. It's not the way we can do business anymore. It's not correct for the officer to be playing a dispatcher, and it's nice that he may know that individual in the community and they have his cell number, because it's a great community relationship. However, if there's an event, emergency or non-emergency, we are going to be asked, even the people within the township, even within our own infrastructure, our emergency managers and our public works people, if they have an incident that requires police department, we want you to call the non-emergency number or the emergency number, depending on the event, for multiple reasons. Number one, it's documented. So it documents our workload and what we're doing. Number two, especially if it's an emergency event, they have trained dispatchers there for a reason. They give you pre-arrival instructions for EMS calls or evacuate the building if it's the fire department. So there's a system in place. There's a system in place for a reason, and we just encourage everybody to use it. So thank you for bringing that up.
Okay. Any other questions for the chief? All right, I'm going to start tonight instead of, Council Floor. Prior to our meeting tonight, we discussed some things that I think is necessary to start doing in the police department. And I think one of them is to upgrade every police officer with a new taser and new training, and upgrade every police officer's handgun to a brand-new handgun. There's a couple programs out there that the chief mentioned that probably would cost the borough about $30,000. So I'm going to put that on the agenda for Monday evening to be voted on to approve all new tasers and all new handguns for the police department. And it's a six-year or five-year interest-free program, so we can elect to either pay it in full, pay so much a year for this, but I think it's something that it needs to be done, and we need to do it as soon as possible. Any questions on that?
No, I just think it's a wonderful idea to also jump on that 0% financing. I mean, you can't beat that.
So I think, Chief, you could proceed knowing that it's going to be on the agenda and there's going to be no objections.
Thank you.
The other thing I want to speak about are the boat docks. We're coming down to crunch time where we're still short $500,000. I've been working on this morning, noon, and night, dealing with a lot of different agencies, a lot of different political people, trying to get this $500,000, and a lot of private individuals that come up with this money in different organizations. My recommendation is to council that we have until the 15th to either accept or reject the bids.
Of June.
that's the last extension that we have. And if we reject the bids on the 15th, most likely the project will not happen. And Kurt, you're here, maybe you could speak on this a little bit. Because by the time we go out the bid again and try to get this whole thing redone, probably the federal grant will run out on the $1.5 million that we have. So my recommendation to council is that we schedule a meeting for June 15th. So we're going to meet Monday, which will be the 13th, and we'll come back Wednesday the 15th to discuss either we got the money, we don't have the money, or how we want to proceed. And I think it'd be pretty good that night to have borough residents here that are either pro or con. I mean, there may be people that are for the docks or against the docks or have any questions about the docks financially or how we're going to do this. But right now we have $2.5 million. And it's a shame that if we have to turn this money back, there's $1 million guaranteed from the county and there's $1.5 million guaranteed from the federal government. So again, it's a $3 million project. And, if we can't get this $500,000, I don't know, what direction council wants to proceed in, but I'm going to schedule, I'm going to tell the manager to advertise a meeting for June 15th at 7 p.m. here in Borough Hall, and it will only be for the docks. And we will be voting that night to either accept or reject the bids. Whether this money comes in, if the money comes in, there may be council still opposed to doing the docks. I don't know. So I don't want to get into a discussion tonight about it. I think that we should schedule this meeting on the 15th, and hopefully we get a nice crowd up here to voice their opinion either for or against it. And same thing with council. We need to make a decision because it's a major decision that we need to make for this town, and a lot of people are stopping me every day hoping that this project moves forward. So
Mr. President, I totally agree with everything that you said as far as having a special meeting for it. I'm just wondering if maybe there's just one little piece of other information we could throw out there for people that come to the meeting, and that is, if we accept it without the extra $500,000, what are we saying? Where is that money coming from?
That's what we'll have to discuss that night.
All right.
I mean, I have some options,
yeah,
but
I
think that...
We can wait.
Again, my thing on this is, we may say on the 15th, the money came through, we have $3 million. And there may be people sitting here saying, I think, I don't want it, no matter if you have the money or not. So, I don't know, how does council, you want to just talk about it a little bit now? I mean, do you think it's a good project, Greg?
Oh, I mean, absolutely. I think it's a tremendous project, and one that, if it coincides with what I know is another agenda item, that, or not agenda item, but informational item about the parking lot, I think the sky's the limit, and yes, I think it's a great project.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a great project, and myself, it's not something that I would decline to move forward if we got the money. I mean, the only concern that I would have is, you know, if we're $500,000 short, and we're already know the, you know, the budgetary issues that we're going forward with this year, the $500,000 is just what it is now. Then you're going to have, you know, the overcost. It's not going to just be $500,000. There's always going to be something that comes up that's going to, you know, it's going to cost us more money.
Right.
Not, you know, so.
But that's the decision you have to make as a
right.
councilman.
Right.
We don't have the money. If we don't get the grant money, we need to vote on doing the project, and that means we have to borrow the money to do it,
mm-hmm.
or we don't do the project.
Right.
So I need everybody to really think hard about where you stand on this.
I know where I stand. If we got to borrow money, I'm not for it. So, I mean, okay. Just so people know now.
All right. Dave?
Yeah, if we got the money, I'm all for it. And if private people come through and kick in that extra $500,000, I'm really all for it. But the taxpayers got to fork out another $500,000, I'd probably vote against it.
Same consensus. If we can't get the money, I'm...
But you can get into a project that you're, let's just say that we have the $500,000 and something goes wrong and we signed this contract and you need another $300,000. We're just saying, you know, what do we do? I mean, so it's, you know, you really need to think about, is this something that is going to be a major impact and how important is this for this town? So I think I like to hear comments from the public and comments from council, but I believe that it may come down to where council is going to have to make a decision that it's going to come down to us maybe having to put money in. So, Betty?
I understand everybody not wanting, I don't think anybody wants to have the taxpayers have anything to do with this. We have enough already on our plate. But hopefully, I mean, if we get the money, I think this is one of the best things that we can utilize, you know, with Mill Street and with the river. And I think we've been waiting for this for years. So I hope that we can find the money or get the money. And once we do that, I would love to see this project go through. But, you know, that's the only way, I guess.
Time to pull the rabbit out of the hat.
Yeah.
Budget time.
But I think people should come on the 15th and tell us how they feel.
I mean, there may be taxpayers that feel it's a well worth the project,
right,
that they think
they need to voice
we should go borrow the money and do the project. I mean, I think we got to hear everybody's opinion on this, but, you know, it's a shame to give back $2.5 million.
Right, I think it's a very positive
for $500,000 project that it's going to benefit this town for the next, you know, 50 years or more.
Exactly.
I mean, we have to build these docks to withstand 25 years. It's part of the grant application. And they're built to where, you know, it doesn't matter about ice and trees and all the stuff coming down the river. The people that are designing these, am I right, Kurt, are people that know what they're doing with these docks. So,
if I might as well, and Kurt might be able to answer this, let's say hypothetically we were to vote to accept the docks with knowing we're $500,000 short. Does that then mean that all of our grant options are gone, or could we continue to pursue other avenues of money even while we accepted the
pay? You always can pursue money.
You understand what I'm saying?
If we sign a contract, we're guaranteeing
the contract. I understand that. Saying
we get it privately. You know,
right. I mean, we
something
could have
can come up in July. We don't. Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
I think it would be hard to award a contract and start construction while seeking new grants.
No. That's not exactly what I meant. What I meant is we guarantee the five. We obviously guarantee the $500,000.
Right.
But in the meantime, try to find other avenues to continue to get money that we can kind of inject into it or back to
sure.
us.
Sure, it would probably have to be more private money, though I doubt you'd
I gotcha.
Be able
to.
I think what the question is, and let me, I don't want to put words in his mouth to rephrase this, is if we sign a contract for whatever the contract is, and the borough has to go borrow this 500, we're just saying we got to borrow 500,000. We're going to use the federal money first, and we're going to use the county money
right.
first.
Right.
The last payment is going to be the borough's payment.
Correct.
If the project takes a year to complete in that year's time, what Greg is saying, and correct me if I'm
no,
wrong,
you're right. Yeah, you're right.
is that we still can keep trying to raise this half a million either sure. through grants or whatever.
And things could go in our favor where the costs don't overrun and we
exactly.
might get the piles where they need to be for less money than what we're projecting them costing.
Right. So there's a lot of things on the table, but I think council right now has to make a decision, and I think I'm hearing that if it's going to cost taxpayers anything, there's going to be some people against
well,
it. So.
Yeah, we'll have a lot of discussion.
All right. Kurt, thank you. Anything else you want to discuss?
Thank you.
Go through council. Greg, what do you have?
I have a few things. Actually, one of them was going to be...
Wait a minute. Wait. I want to go this way.
Okay. No problem.
I started.
It's all good. I saw the look Betty gave you. It's good.
First of all, I'd like to say happy birthday to Ralph. He just turned 60, and I'd like to wish him a big happy birthday and many, many, many more.
Thank you.
That being said, I have a few little complaints. I know Market Street has been an issue with the stop signs that we've put there, and people in the neighborhood are happy. They said that, you know, a lot of times their kids would be run over if it wasn't for the stop signs. Problem I'm having now is that coming out of Cedar Street, when you look to your left, we have that parking area where the cars are parked this way.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you come to the stop sign, you have to kind of inch out so that you can see mm-hmm. if anybody's coming. When they're coming off of Mill Street, it doesn't seem to be too bad. But when they're coming down Ratcliffe, they're just zooming around that corner. I don't know what we can do to help that area out, but I know several people on Cedar Street are a little concerned. Almost got into car accidents. People are not slowing down. I don't know if we need to put the stop thing over there to, you know, to regulate the speed machine. We'll call it, or maybe a cop sit out there for a little while and just see what we can do to help that area out. So that's one. We have some graffiti on Otter Street, right across from the playground, along that long white fence. If you can get in touch with the people from the graffiti. I'd like to thank Tom Rudisile for the beautiful job he did with the Coke sign on Pinelli's, Greg Pinelli's building.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I walked around there a couple times as he was doing it. I couldn't believe how fast he did it, mm-hmm. but he did an amazing job. We're pretty lucky to have someone like him come into town, who's from town, and do that up. That was really beautiful. We talked about the non-emergency phone calls. I was lucky enough to go to the library to celebrate their 50 years in service in Bristol Borough. That was a wonderful thing. They had a lot of things set up and a lot of people came out. And sometimes people, maybe new people that are sending their kids to school, you know, it's so expensive to send your kids to college and buy those books, and you spend so much money on these books. And then they have that buy back program where you spend like $300, $400 on a book, and then when you try to sell it back, my daughter was tickled. She was like, oh, I get money. You get $20 for the $400 book I bought. I said, for that, just burn it. I mean, it's not enough. But the library offers a lot of the books that these kids have in school. I mean, it doesn't hurt to stop there and check and rent the books instead of actually paying for these books. It helps out the library and it helps out your pocket. So I also, let me see, there's something else. Library celebrated with you. Oh, this weekend, Raising the Bar, I had a big affair. Which I didn't get to go, and maybe Greg could talk a little about it.
I wasn't there either.
But you weren't there either?
No, I wasn't.
But I heard they, you know, it was beautiful. I saw a lot of pictures on Facebook, and, you know, congrats to all of those people that worked so hard for that. There was also just a lot going on in this town. There was at the Grundy, they had a boxing match
which a lot of people were able to go to, and I believe whoever was boxing was from this area. So that's something else that seems to be, I don't know, if you look and you take your time, there is a lot happening in Bristol Borough, and I think we should all be proud of that, because this town is small, but it's got a lot going. And let's not forget First Fridays. First Fridays seem to be working out fine. The first one, they kind of got it rained out, but the second one was really good. I think it's great what's going on in Bristol. And congratulations to the softball girls. Varsity softball girls won today and will continue playing, and hopefully they'll get to states. So that's it. Thank you.
You're welcome. Tony.
I'd like to thank Mr. Dillon and the borough crew for installing a street light in the alley between Swain and Linden Street. There's a dark area there, and the traffic was, you couldn't see anybody back there, so that really helps out. Thank you. Also, I've gotten a couple complaints about people parking on the grass, and Mr. Miller went out there and kind of informed me. It's my understanding is that that's a zoning violation. There's nothing that he could really do himself. So I think the process is that he goes, that it's a zoning violation, they have to approach zoning, and there's a 30-day period, then there's a 10-day or 11-day appeal process and all that. So I was hoping that we could maybe introduce a standalone ordinance that would stop, you know, that give him a little bit more bite to go out there and actually cite somebody for parking on the grass behind
that. Where's this at, Tony?
It was up along Bass Street. There was Bass.
Oh, I think it's on public property.
Oh, no, these are residential.
Oh,
residential areas, I'm sorry. But I know if somebody parks on the cement, it becomes a police issue. If somebody's on the sidewalk, things like that. I was informed that, you know, so if I take my car and I park it up on my grass behind my home along Bass Street, that it's, you know, we're not, it's a zoning violation, and there's not really much John could do. He has to send something in the mail, and then they have to go to the zoning and all that. So I don't know if there's something we can introduce. I think the wording is a standalone ordinance.
Billy?
I'm not aware that the zoning doesn't work, because basically the way it is they get a letter from Sally stating you're in violation of the zoning notice, I mean of the zoning ordinance. You either cure it in 30 days or you have to put up the money to go to zoning. I think 99 times out of 10 people cure it. So it's my understanding it works. So it doesn't involve John having to take somebody to magistrate court and they get to argue. But we could talk to John and Sally to see, but the process is not really that cumbersome. It's done all the time.
And it did work in this instance, it did.
Pardon me?
I did have a complaint, it did work in that instance, he just went out there to get
my experience is it does, because people don't want to come up and put the $250 to apply to zoning, and zoning's not going to have a whole lot of sympathy if somebody's violating the ordinance. And maybe it's good for the public to know is just because it's your property, if you're going to park, you got to park on stone, on macadam. We don't want people parking on grass because it creates a problem with mud and stormwater problems, et cetera, and a lot of reasons. So maybe we'll discuss it with John. And if the system's working, let's keep doing it.
Okay.
But if we need to do an ordinance, I guess we can do that.
And last thing is the clothes drop-off over at the Commerce Shopping Center. It's behind the McDonald's and the Pizza Hut. It's just, I was by there the last couple of days, by there again tonight, and it's just, it looks like people are just throwing trash around. It looks horrible. I don't know if we get
I brought that up last month.
Yes,
we
did.
At the diner.
Yes.
But I saw that one today. The trash, it looks like trash. I don't know how people are thinking of dropping
it
stuff off.
It is trash.
It's all outside of the box and bags and bags. I'm going to call it trash, because when it rains, all that stuff gets ruined anyway. Who's going to give that to somebody? I don't know.
Once in a while, you get a nice suit.
Oh, really?
you got to get it right, though.
There's trash on top of it, along
no,
the ground.
It looks
it's all over. It's
whose bin is it, do you know?
It's between Pizza Hut.
I mean, is it Goodwill?
It's a blue one. It
I can go find out and just have John send him a letter.
All right. Okay.
Tell him if they don't, he'll take care of it.
I saw it.
That's it.
Dave.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ralph. I gave Mr. Dillon a list of some potholes on the North Ward. Also, I saw some activity at 847 Pine Street. The grass, somebody cut the grass, and a bunch of trash out there. I'd like to ask Mr. Dillon to look into that, see if the bank took over or we got a new homeowner in there. I'd like to see if we could recover our $11,000 for fixing that wall that the borough invested in that property. And I also got a call from a friend concerning the skating rink. She says her group of her friends, 10 to 15 of them, used to get in there early in the morning, nice and cool, or if it's raining, and walk around the skating rink. They felt protected, and they would be willing to kick in some money, you know, once a month to have that open for them. So if the borough or Jim would like me to look into that, I'll organize that. And it wouldn't be a lot of money, but if we could get 20 people, maybe it'd be a couple thousand dollars a year just to have the people walking around inside there. So that's all I got.
Donnie?
I don't really have anything except I want to, you know, say thank you to the chief. I definitely have seen, just in the borough itself, more officers, more visibility, and, you know, and what you're saying now is we have some walking patrols that you're working on, bike patrol. That's, you know, that's exciting, and I think a lot of borough residents, you know, are very excited to see the new police presence. So that's all I have.
Right.
Most of what I have was what the public participation was about, and that is the Mill Run situation as well as Elkhorn. But I wanted to reiterate what I think most of us are thinking and saying about the police department, and the chief certainly seems to understand this better than us, but it's those, even just the very little things, like seeing those guys lined up at the Veterans Memorial celebration was a really nice thing, you know, and it just really did let the town people know that they're there, and I just thought it was a really, really great touch, and I think it's a really good thing for the community and for the police officers themselves, for people to get to see them at those events. So I appreciate that. I also wanted to congratulate the Veterans Memorial Committee, you know, for another great event that they put on Memorial Day. They do it every year, and they keep great care, and we help them, of course, with that memorial itself. And it's a beautiful thing, and it's a really great addition to town. I know that took a long time for them to get together, and we sometimes maybe take for granted those little projects that really look good. So I wanted to thank them and congratulate them again. To reiterate what Betty said, Bristol Borough Business Association for First Fridays, they're doing a fantastic job. And that does kind of bring me then to a question, though. I think it's for Mr. Dillon. It may be something that the chief would know about, maybe not yet, but the Mill Street parking lot, aside from the condition which it's in, which I know Kurt has some ideas about that, and then I know it's on our radar as far as how the condition of it is and maybe to improve it. And you know, I say this with some reservations because I don't want to mess with any business that anyone's doing, and I know some people are utilizing that and that we've kind of allowed them to utilize it unofficially because it is helping their business and we'd love to see them get on their feet. But some of the automobiles or trucks or whatever it is that are parked there overnight and at all hours of the day and are taking up like 20 parking spots at a time. I just don't think that they necessarily reflect well when we're having these events and when. So I say it with reservations because I want to see if we can just maybe formalize some sort of relationship with the people that are parking there, or at least I honestly don't know the rules about parking down there. And I don't know if there are any rules about parking down there. If it's public parking 24/7, and if that is the case, should we keep it that way? I don't know. Do we have rules about that lot?
What we have, I think what you're alluding to is a business operating down there in a public, when they should have their own facility. So I think we could, you know, put them on notice that they can't park 5, 6, 7 vans down there.
Right.
Okay. But other than that, it is a public parking lot.
24/7?
24/7 at the moment, unless council wants to change it or something.
Okay. And I don't know, is it common for a public parking lot to be 24/7? Is that a general rule of thumb, or are there many that would say, you know, public parking from dusk till midnight or something like that? I don't know. And I don't know if the chief has thoughts on that as far as whether or not it would benefit us for it to not be a place where people park overnight. I'm just curious because I don't know what your experience is with public parking lots as far as 24/7.
Sometimes, again, it's commuter parking, and it's up to the businesses how late they're open, and so on and so forth. It'd be more of the borough's decision for that aspect of it. We have received several complaints over the last week regarding kids hanging out, groups hanging out, people actually changing their oil down there. Mm-hmm. We've issued, I think I'm up to 11 citations. We pretty much have a zero tolerance policy down there for drinking in public. We made a couple arrests, and also, again, for the people misusing it for doing the business with their cars down there. So, yeah, it's catch 22. It really is. We want people to
Well,
parking and seeking the vehicles. I know there's ordinances against that.
Right.
So
right. Well, I don't want to see us make a rash decision. I'm not asking that we put something on the agenda for next week to say, here are the rules. But, again, as Kurt has addressed before, and it was one of the items for consideration about opportunities for the parking lot, what could be done down there. Maybe we just want to think about how we want the parking lot to look and how we want the parking lot to be utilized as well. And maybe we can formalize that at some point after we kind of get input from people around there. And just a thought.
Yeah, I think, I mean, to jump in, I think that's a good idea because, to me, that area, when you have all those cars down there, if it's 24/7, it's like you don't really know what's down there. And I'm talking about the, I don't want to say that, the people that are, that tend to be down there at certain times of the night aren't the most savory of people. So the less traffic that you have there, the less cars, the more, I guess it would be easier for the police to kind of monitor what's going on when there shouldn't be cars there. So the question I have is, what would be the reason that we would want them to be 24/7 down there?
That's a good question. I don't know the answer. Maybe some people that live on Mill Street, but that I'm sure we could.
Well, we could work something. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
All right. Well, just something to consider is all.
Anything else?
No.
Bill, do you have anything? Jim?
Just a couple things. One, the for Monday evening is the proposed award of a CoStar bid for the sewer replacement vehicle to Fred Bean's Ford in the amount of $31,915 per the recommendation of Mr. Waldron. That email was in your packet. Also, there's some grant funding opportunities for Mill Street parking lot and the Otter Creek and Adams Hollow, and that proposed that email was in your packet, and Mr. Schroeder's here tonight to chat about that, to see if you have any questions. Minor expenditures to get these applications filed. So, Kurt, you want to give us a quick synopsis, please?
Yeah, there's a new round of state funding that is available right now, and if you recall, we've applied for each of these projects in the past. We applied for the Adams Hollow Otter Creek project a year ago with hopes of hearing about that grant application several months from the date in which we applied, but with the budget impasse out in Harrisburg, they delayed the award of any applicants for that program actually until the middle of this month. Well, then the same program has a deadline to apply at the end of this month. So we're not going to find out if we got last year's funding until the middle of the month, but we're recommending that we're poised and ready to resubmit that same grant application to DCED. That's for $75,000, which would be basically given us, we'd give it right to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, who has available funding already that they've in writing committed to us, but we just had to find the $75,000 to match their $75,000 in-kind services so they could do a $150,000 study themselves to try and help mitigate a lot of the floodplain problems that we're having. Some of the flooding that we're having at intersections, it's a public safety issue, and we had about 400 new residents, which is an awful lot, added to the floodplain recently. So we know we have a flooding problem, and this is a way to try to come up with a solution so Army Corps can do a study to figure out what options we have. With the Mill Street parking lot, through that same funding source, which is the Act 13 Marcellus Shale fund source that they tax the Marcellus Shale, they give money to DCD, and DCD allocates it out to municipalities. There's that flood hazard mitigation that we're talking about, but there's also a Greenways Trails and Recreation Program, which we think would be a good program to try to secure funding to work on the Mill Street parking lot. If you recall, earlier this year we applied to the county for CDBG funds. We had two applications into them. One was for Mill Street, one was for the ADA curb ramps throughout town. We aren't totally shut out of that money. The county's still kind of figuring out what to do with some of the money they sort of set aside in reserve that they still want to give to towns like Bristol, but they haven't come out and awarded anything to us as of yet. So this would be another shot at trying to get funding secured for Mill Street parking lot so that we can sort of do phase two, if you will, of the riverfront redevelopment, phase one being the implementation of the boat docks, and phase two would be coming up with a refined master plan of redeveloping that parking lot. It could just be, you know, redoing all the asphalt and curbs and medians and, you know, trees and lights, and just giving it a nice state-of-the-art look, or it could be something a lot more far-reaching, like perhaps even trying to remove, you know, restrictions for non-development on it from the state or other things of that sort. So it would be a planning procedure and then a final design and permitting to sort of set that project up for another construction phase.
Any questions for Kirk? Before we end, I just want to bring up just a couple minor things. One, if everybody at home would, and I don't know how to come off with this, but I'm asking people that have trees in front of their homes or on the corners, if you could just go out and clean around the tree, the base of the tree. It doesn't cost you any money to do this. It's sweep your sidewalk. I mean, when you come through town and you see some of these trees, the base of the tree, there's mulch, there's dirt on the sidewalk. I mean, sweep your sidewalk. We're not asking you to spend money. We're just asking for the overall appearance of our town. We got so many people with so many positive things about Bristol. And you come into town and you travel down some of these streets and you see, it's just, to me, it's annoying. So if you could just do the town a favor and go out and just clean up the front of your property a little bit. And this isn't all over town. I don't want it to look like it's a major problem, but it is a problem and it's very noticeable in certain areas. So if you could just do us a favor and go out and, if you're too old, you're elderly, maybe your neighbor can do it for you and just go out and try to make these tree bases look a lot nicer. And before we end, I just want to say to council, and I know how three of you guys feel about these docks, I really want you to think hard about it, because this decision is going to impact this town for many, many years. And with all the development, everything that Raising the Bar tried to accomplish and all the other groups and this council, by bringing this town from where it was into where it is today, and we are now known everywhere. I mean, there's people that idolize what's going on here, and there's other townships and borough that try to duplicate things that we do. I think by turning this down, it's going to be a major mistake. And I, you know, everybody can vote how they want to vote, but sometimes spending money isn't a bad thing. I mean, it's, you know, it's not always about the next election or about trying to get reelected. And, you know, I just think that if you really care enough about this town, and I'm voting yes, whether we got to borrow the money or whatever we got to do, I am not going to have this project turned down because we can't raise the other half a million. And I am out there. When I tell you this has been a quest for me for the last few months, trying to make this happen, and I still feel confident that it will. And you know, but you know, everybody can vote yes when it doesn't cost anything. It takes, you know.
Ralph, when you're talking to these private people, what are they saying? They're going to kick in, $20,000, $30,000?
It's not, I'm not going to on a $20,000 level. I'm trying to get people, you know, $50,000, $100,000, $200,000. And like Greg said, maybe there'll be a time where we're 200 short and we could do some fun. Then we go into this, you know, smaller bunch of people. But right now, there's a lot of commitments that were made, but nobody has said, you know, everybody keeps saying, don't worry, we're going to get it for you. Don't worry, we're going to do this. And we know how important it is to this town. And just to let you know, the Grundy Foundation is 150% behind this project, and they want to see it happen also. So, and they're willing to help. So, I mean, there's a lot of things, but, you know, sometimes as a councilman or councilwoman, you need to step up to the plate to show other people that you're willing to make that tough decision and do what's right for the town. Not about telling everybody, I voted against this because it was going to cost taxpayers money, which to me, you know, that's not the right decision. Because if we would have been sitting here 10 years ago, this building still wouldn't be done, and the streets wouldn't be done, and roads would. So there's a lot, and I don't even want to get into all that. But I say make the right decision for what's right for the town. And whether if you feel that way, there's no hard feelings. But you really got to consider doing the right thing on this project. Tony.
Yeah. Ralph, when you say things like that, don't do it for, you know, for the next election, or don't do it for, you know, do it for the right reasons. I think that you have to understand, to me, the reason why I vote the way I vote is because that's what the people in my, you know, in my ward, my constituents, is what's important to them. And that's the reason I vote the way I do. And to me, it is an absolute, it's a great project. But it's not, to me, being in the, you know, the area, the financial position that we're in now, to me, it doesn't make sense for us to spend any money to be able to do something unless it's bringing money in, right? And I understand what you're saying. Sometimes you got to spend a little money to get, I understand, but I want to be able to bring something to the table in the sense of it's bringing something in. It's not just costing us money. And if it isn't, I want it to be not where just a small portion of the borough uses it. To me, if we're going to spend money, I want to do it in rec. I want to do it for the kids in the community. And just like we have over at the old tennis courts, the group now, we have one of those, you know, first basketball courts, the tennis courts where they are, they now have the small gardens, which are nice. The problem is now is that it's taking away from what the kids can do in that area. So now we have a court there that needs to be resurfaced, it needs to be upgraded, it needs to put some lights in there. And it's like we're only kind of catering to, you know, the older people in the community, you know, what would look nice. And to me, I want to spend money on things that are going to help the kids and, you know, the younger people kind of build some pride in themselves and have something that they can do. So, I mean, that's where my thought process is when it comes to, you know, talking about spending money, is that I want to do it where, you know.
But did you actually talk to, you polled your entire ward to see if they're for this or against it?
I don't have to
poll my entire ward. Just like, I mean, do you poll your entire ward? No, you're making a decision.
I think they elected me to make a decision, but exactly. To say that they don't want this.
Exactly. That's your position.
Let's talk about this on the 15th.
Okay.
All I'm saying is I really wish you three guys would really consider this. If the money doesn't come in, or even if we get the $500,000, that's not saying it's not going to cost us money down the road. So
hey,
you really need.
I heard Betty say she didn't want to hit the taxpayer. So
I said I didn't want to. I didn't say I was going to go.
Yeah, I didn't say I would.
Well, let me finish. Betty can speak for herself. I've been on council longer than you guys. We've been trying to get this project going for many, many years. Something always seems to stop us. I would love to see us be able to get the money, of course. But in the long run, I'm going to see what happens, what's going to be the best option. I want it. It's in my ward. It's going to benefit everything that has to do with Mill Street, with those new condos coming in, with the restaurants, with the many, many projects that we have going on already. It's only going to advance and benefit this town.
It's economic development. And Dave, I don't mean it the wrong way. I don't want you to take it that, you know, I'm saying you're doing, it's your decision. I mean, if you really feel in your heart that's the right decision, there's no hard feelings with that.
Of course we want it.
You know what I mean? But I sometimes you got to make a decision. It's like this building. If we would have listened to certain people, we wouldn't. This building may not even be here today because everything in the building was in deplorable condition. The roofs were leaking. The windows were falling out. You washed your hands at the water fountain when you went to the bathroom. So if we did, if look, you can't base every decision on what somebody says to you because you're never going to make everybody happy. And you know, it's the nature of the game. You're only as good as your last decision. And all I'm saying is you got a week and a half to think about it. Consider it, because if the money doesn't come in, we need to make a decision. And if the money does come in, we still need to, you're going to be on the hook for anything over on that. So you can't say, well, we raised another half a million, I'm voting yes, and then when it comes time that we need another $300,000, everybody says, well, wait a minute, you said you raised the money. So I just want everybody to know up front. And I think if there's people in your wards or throughout this town, no matter if it's your ward, my ward, that think this is the wrong or right decision, now's the time to come and voice your opinion. Not after the horse is out of the gate. Come now and give us, you know, your decision on what you think.
Well, I think that's what we're doing. I mean, to me, this is something that it's not like we've discussed. This is how we feel.
And that's fine.
And the thing about it is you got to understand, too, is that the residents, they see what happens when projects get started, right? That the borough yard, that project, the maintenance building, started at like $600,000.
No, it didn't.
It did.
All right.
Why do you get so mad?
I'm not getting mad.
This is what you do. You want to shut it down. It started out like $600,000. That's what you said it would be. Okay. And it went over $3 million. So the taxpayers see that that's what's going to happen. So when you say $500,000, they know it's going to be more than that. It's not like it's going to come in, you know, it's going to come in or under what we're expecting. It's going to come over. Always does. I mean, you're in that field. You know it does.
First of all, the borough yard, you were cited from the DEP. And the borough yard had to be cleaned up whether you built the building or not. So you need to put this all your facts on the table, and we could discuss that anytime you want intelligently.
We could start
but
now.
But don't say it was a $600,000 project that ended up $3
million. That's what it started out.
All right, anybody have anything else? Can I get a motion to adjourn? Second by who?
Second.